who is, by the way, a staff sergeant, which has bugged him already because he hasn't gotten the extra stripes, you see. He is a staff. He should have the other stripes, you know. He's just... So he says, all right, you guys. First thing, you got to know how we do stuff around here. You guys got your general orders memorized? Before you get a pass, general orders got to be memorized. Lights out are at 11:30. I don't want any... Three unprintable words. I don't want any of that. And furthermore, we have a full field inspection at 1200 every Saturday. And I don't want no noise in the barracks when the lights are out. No noise in the barracks when the lights are out. Now, it is now Friday. You guys are going to expect a pass tomorrow on Saturday. Forget it. Okay? Forget it. All right? Get out. Well, we get out, we walk on the steps. We're now in the Army, see? So I look at Zinsmeister and I say, well, what do you think, Zinsmeister? He just shrugs his shoulders. I say, how about it, Gasser? That's all he says. And so we go clumping down the steps over in the direction of our barracks, which has been assigned to us, Barracks 1 and 2. So we arrive in Barracks 1 and 2, and there is a feeling in the air immediately. It's that nutty office. It is there. It is hanging like a great big fat cloud, a great big sullen cloud of DDT in the air. You can smell it. The place is crawling with human cockroaches. And not only that, you can smell, you really can, you can smell some kind of unnameable violence that's just hanging there like a little green cloud that floats over your head when you walk, and it comes out of the barracks, just comes floating out and meets in the middle of the street and washes back. Walk down. Old Shep goes in. He opens up the barracks door there. It's a screen door. Barracks 1 walks in, looks halfway up and down the barracks there, and he sees about a third of the way down. On his left, he sees the sack that is his. They told me, you know, pick any sack. Well, the way the sacks work in the Army is they have the empty bed there, you know, with the springs, and they have the big rolled-up mattress at the end. So old Shep walks down there, and he's got his barracks bag over his back. Old Corporal Shepherd, he walks down, plunks the bag down on the thing, and a guy out of the darkness says, what are you doing, man? And I says, I'm taking this sack. I look, you know, right away I'm on the muscle. I wouldn't do that. So what do you mean I wouldn't do it? I'm going to sleep here, Mac. Okay. I'm among friends. So I open up my barracks bag. I take up my tin hat. Put it up on the shelf. Boom! So, look around in the darkness. And the guy is gone. I start emptying the junk out, you know. Shoes. I hang my stuff up one after the other. I look and see how they're doing it. I hang it up. Everything's okay. So I go cooling it out now. I go out. About 5 minutes later, there's Gasser walking around up the street. So the three of us are walking around. It's about an hour and a half after supper now, see, so it's, you know, fooling around. Go down to the club. Come. It's now about 9 o'clock, 9:45. And the lights are yellower than they've ever been anyplace else. We were scared to death by now that we would be permanently assigned to this company. You never know in the Army, you know. Our orders read temporary assignment. Well, waiting shipping orders. But it's awful tenuous, you know. And we arrive in this outfit, and they're all sitting around. And every guy in that outfit, let me tell you, there must have been about 300 guys. We're all sitting, if you can imagine, a 360-degree circle. Well, each guy was at a different angle from the other. There wasn't one guy that was looking at one other guy with anything but sheer hatred in his eye. Not one. Not one, I'm telling you. So we're walking through this thing, you know, in this silence. You don't hear any of that, ha, 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 oh, Mac, you know, none of this stuff. Nothing comes out of these barracks, nothing. The orderly room is like a tomb. Dead silence. So Gasser and Zinsmeister and I were kind of huddling together, you know. let's cut out of the PX, huh? Got some Mars bars. Maybe they got some Milky Ways in, huh? Have a beer. Beer. So we go on down to the PX. Now, this is a sad PX. I don't know whether you know about entertainment in the Army. But entertainment consists of a wooden shack. And on the outside of the wooden shack is a little chicken wire enclosure with two picnic tables there. And a great big GI can that says, "Thrun, you're a junk here." That means you, Mac. And they got about four yellow light bulbs that hang out of the sky. And in this wooden shack, there is a wooden counter. And behind the wooden counter, there is a corporal who has a cooler there, which is filled with soupy water, warm. And out of the soupy warm water, he gives you cans of this obscene beer. And it's even warmer than the water. So you go out and you sit there in this darkness with a yellow light bulb hanging over you, and you open the cans of this terrible beer and pretend it's good. Oh, hi, Carl, a great beer. Well, you finish one of these, and then the biggest kick of the night is scoring a basket with your empty can in the GI thing. Now you go. Well, the next day, we wake up. Nobody says a word. We all stand out there. They're calling out roll. That's the only sound we've ever heard in this outfit. That afternoon, we go down to the orderly room, and we ask if we can get passes like we always do.
I told you guys to forget it the first week. Forget it.
Smart guys.
Beat it, will you?
No? Okay. So now we got a whole weekend yawning ahead of us. Nothing to do but fool around and scratch. So we go down for the whole weekend, you know. We go in and out and pretend like we're always having big fun buying Mars bars. We'd buy a Mars bar and we'd run out and holler, "They got Mars bars!" And then you'd eat a Mars bar and you run back in again. And so you have a can of this rotten beer and you holler. And then you pretend. You see, one of the great things in the Army is pretending you're drunk. On beer, believe me, a beer that couldn't get a guppy drunk. And you pretend it. You see, you drink one of these. Then an empty comes. "Sit up, Mac. Come on, cut out the fooling around." Then you sit up. Okay, all right. Cold stone sober in the market. So it goes like that all day long. And finally, Sunday night, we go down to the club, and we eat down at the club. They have this little crummy cafeteria where they sell rubber sandwiches. So we go down there, and we eat at the club. Well, we come out of the club. We start walking back down through the streets, which are about a mile away, until we get to the gate where it says entering area 2. And there's an MP there. He says, "You guys from Company A?" And we said, "Yeah." He said, "Boy, you better get back to Company A fast, man, on the double. Quick, get down there. That's an order. Now move." Well, we run with our pants. We don't know what happened. You know, we're running down there, and we arrive at the orderly room. And standing out in front of the orderly room is the staff sergeant, and he is checking everybody's pass in there. "All right, Shepherd, get in there fast. Get in there fast. Now move. Get going, Gasser." And he's got our passes. He's yanking everything all the way down the line. So we say, whoa, "What's the matter?" And we're walking through the company street, and the barracks are closed, locked. You see, the day room. The day room has burnt down. There is nothing standing there but this little pile of bricks. And in the middle of the pile of bricks is this USO upright piano. And it's all scorched. And there's our Coke machine scorched. Nothing. Smoke is coming out. We get into the barracks and we walk in. And there are these stone faces. Nothing but hate coming out of their agate marble eyes. And I say to the guy in the next bunk, "What happened?" "None of your damn business." I said, "Come on, what happened?" "Somebody burnt down a day room." And we're sitting there on our bunks waiting, and all of a sudden it comes, "All right, you guys, we're going to start the investigation at tomorrow morning, 0800, 0800. And believe me, there's going to be plenty of rear ends burnt around here, starting at 0800. That night, at 11:15, the three of us got our orders. Shipped out of that outfit, and I never heard another word. And it's been stuck down in my craw. I wonder where they went. What happened to them? Did they survive? Are they still alive? Who burnt down the day room? Who burnt down the day room? Who did it? Why?